living in retirement worth having is really about the people in our lives that we really care for and we really are in love with, and the ones that really produce for us a spirit of peace of mind, and openly a lot of other aspects of our life are coming together because they are aligning themselves with us. In our spiritual world, we have lots of people who think that they know the Lord, but when it comes time to helping others, they don't always do the right thing. They sometimes fail people on purpose to harm their lives in a way that they think the Lord is leading them. Well, and that's therein the difference, that the Lord in heaven does not lead people to harm people's lives. The Lord in heaven leads people to be prestigious, to be loving, to be peaceful, to be honoring of others and their souls that he places within them. You see, the human body is something that will fade away over the course of time. Cellular degeneration literally does happen, and it openly happens every single day. Our life's work is not in our physical beings most of the time, unless we're vain about who we are and what we look like, but in truth, what is present within the Lord's house is what we do to honor other people. When we dishonor other people's souls, when we think that we have God's plan for them, we literally get off track with the Lord's house. We start to have difficulties in our professional life. We start to have relationship troubles in our personal life, and we openly don't always know what is the right way to proceed once we've had a mistake in a relationship that means more than the world to us. How do we fix it? How do we make it better? How do we start again? How do we start anew? How do we literally say, look, I love you regardless of what's happened here, and I want to fix everything. I want to return it to a productive and positive situation between us, and I really want you to know how much I deeply love you. But I'm not going to put my ideas on your life for what you should have in your life. I'm simply going to say, I want you to look at your life, and I want you to decide whether or not your life has proceeded in a manner in which you feel the Lord has put forward for you in terms of lessons and hardships because of some mistake you've made in your relationships with others, or whether you feel the Lord is blessing you in some way because of all the things you've done to submit everything you are to Him. You see, those of us who submit everything we are to the Lord sometimes get incredible blessings, but they're not always monetary. There's sometimes incredible lessons, there's sometimes beautiful journeys, there's sometimes prosperous opportunities, but in the Lord's house, it takes more than one person to make those things come to pass. There are plenty of people who will mob someone, that will participate in the harm and detriment of an individual because in their mind, the Lord didn't make them like they made someone else, or something to that crazy effect, that they think that they literally have power over someone. The truth is the only power in this universe and in this land is God in heaven. Most people don't think that because they're so busy powering their own lives. They use technology, they use email, they use internet, they use LinkedIn, they use Facebook to power their lives into some sort of opportunity, some sort of career move, some sort of strategy to find a relationship. And literally what ends up happening is they might be putting themselves completely out of the plan that the Lord has for them. And in doing so, they sort of incur the wrath of the Lord. They start to gain difficulties in their own situations. They start to have little problems start to crop up between themselves and their children. They start to have difficulties with the man that they chose and that they think is so godly. Well, maybe he's not so godly. Maybe she is not so perfect, the person that you might have chosen. And maybe it's because you perfectly did not ask the Lord whether or not this individual was right for you. Now, I talk a lot about that because I have seen so many opportunities missed by people who call themselves Christians to simply help someone take one step forward and move one inch closer to the plan that the Lord has, not only for that individual, but for the person who is set up to help them. You see, there are many men who say, I can't help you with certain things because they've not thought of how the Lord might look at them and might actually be testing them to see whether or not they are truly on the house of the Lord's team or not. You see, in order to prove that you're in the house of the Lord, which is the way that the heavenly hosts talk about heaven, apparently, allegedly, according to a variety of spiritual and religious works, that when you're in the house of the Lord, you think about other people first. You put your emotions last. You decide that you are not the Lord of other people, and you don't say or do anything illegal, immoral, or illicit in terms of lying and stealing and cheating a person out of their life plan that the Lord put in place for them. You see, there are plenty of people who want to say that they know what God is all about, that they think that God is just some creature up in heaven, someplace looking down, playing a game in their life. And they will often lay the responsibility of the messes they've made in their life on another human being. I have someone that I love deeply, more than life itself sometimes, who continues to say and suggest in text messages when she bothers to respond in an adult manner that somehow I did something to monkey her life. And I thought, how is that even remotely possible? I haven't seen you in, gosh, possibly 7 years. You barely talk when I try to text and say, hey, let's get together for coffee, let's get together for tea, let's have a conversation to produce a positive, peaceful result. Let's see if we can help one another move forward through these challenges in life. And openly, God put us on a plan together, but you're kind of monkeying it up because you don't want to take the time to fix something you should have fixed a long time ago. Now, that's just me professing that I know the Lord's plan, right? Not exactly. What I'm saying is that when people continue to pop up, when they continue to say, hey, look, I'd really like to fix this, when you reject that peace-oriented prospect, that peace-oriented process, you literally say, I am not tolerating you because God is not in me. Now think about this. Biblically, we're supposed to go to people when we have a problem and say, look, we're having a meltdown here, we're having a communication difficulty, and I'd really like to fix it. And then, if that doesn't work, we're supposed to grab another person and say, hey, I really need to talk to this individual, and I'd really like them to be willing to talk to me, and I need some help to produce some peace in my heart, mind, and soul about what's going on between us, and I literally need to know what the heck happened. We were such good friends and all this sort of stuff, but we don't always do that. What we end up doing is telling our version of the story to someone who ends up giving us an opinion about whether or not they should or shouldn't help, instead of simply acting as a liaison to say, listen, I don't really know what's happened here, but I think it's worth it based on some of the things I've heard that you give this a chance, that you openly give this a try, that you might realize that maybe God is punishing you both for not fighting hard enough to keep it together. You see, when relationships are put together and when paths are crossed, there's always an opportunity. There's an opportunity to soar with each other. I so meet so many men who are so busy being the man on campus or the big man in town that they miss helping that lesser person. And in that regard, they learn absolutely nothing from that individual. They sort of surmise in their mind that there's no way that individual could help me possibly in my world, in my work, in my career, in my profession. But that is a fool's game. How could you possibly know what plan the Lord has for you if you don't play it out fully? You see, playing it out fully means you take a risk. It means you're going to say, you know, I'm not sure what's going on here, but this was an odd experience for me. This was a unique thing. This was not an everyday situation between me and this individual. This was really something important at one time to me. And it might not be the same importance right now, but what if it was supposed to be everything to me? What if practically the Lord sent me someone so modest and humble that I was to learn from them as much as they were to learn from me? And practically, what if this was the match made in heaven that I've been looking for my business, for partnerships, for profitability, for any aspect of selling more? You see, you never know until you have really deep conversations with people what the Lord has a plan for. And then your mind starts to wander and starts to get these ideas and starts to brainstorm. And then you start to see the possibilities of strategic alliances and profitable partnerships and making more for life for everyone involved. You see, that's what life is really about. It's about partnering the right people after losses. I have a girlfriend of sorts who literally married the wrong guy twice. And as a result, she's plasticized her face. She's gotten plastic surgery all over her body. And she is no longer as lovely as she once was because she's trying so hard to please that man who is so into pornography and other things that is so inappropriate, it's not even funny. Now, even if I mention something like this, you think this is ill will. It's not. It's an observation. It's an opinion. It's opinion rendered. That if she had picked a man who just would love her for her soul, it wouldn't matter how she aged. And the truth is, she's absolutely gorgeous underneath human standards of American girl style visuality. And I'm not someone who looks at that all the time. I'm usually looking at a person's soul. I'm saying, what are they producing in this world that's loving, that's honorable, that's true? What are they doing that's producing, that's harming people? And that's how I'm kind of assessing whether or not I'll align myself with someone or not. How did they treat me in those first moments? Did they treat me like a welcomed guest, or did they treat me like a side wheel, a third party, someone who's not to be bothered with? And that's sort of the challenges in churches today, that when people go in to visit, they're either welcome and enfolded immediately, or they're put kind of at bay, like, why is this person here, and why do they dress so funny, and what's up with that beard, and, you know, they go through this litany of I don't really know what's going on with him, but I don't like it here, and we're going to keep our little circle small. And that's a fool's game, because the Lord puts people on a path to an organization for a reason. And openly, that's what we do. We put ourselves on paths in a way that allow us to meet other people. And once we meet that other person, life changes. It shifts. In one particular case, maybe two in my life, I've had two women, amazing women, totally change my entire outlook on life. How often does that happen? Next to none, right? But practically, they have lost their opportunities with me and to learn what I've learned over the years of not being with them because they're so busy being enraged. They're so busy being not themselves. They're so busy saying, I don't need this situation. Well, what if the Lord had planned there to be more in that situation than they allowed? What if so much opportunity has been missed because of that lack of maturity, that lack of social responsibility, that lack of saying, you know, we've had a breakdown, let's figure this out and let's move past it? Because all relationships have ups, downs, turns, inside outs, and what's tried and true is the one that stays with it and says, you know what, I don't care what's happened between us, but I love you deeply, and my soul is not the same since you left me. And that's how I feel about one particular person. I might feel that way about two, possibly three, but in my lifetime, only one has moved my soul in a way that I can barely control. And when that happens, I'm pretty sure that's God saying, don't let go. Whatever it takes, keep prayerful. Whatever it means, keep trying. But openly, when the Lord says something like that, you just try not to give up. That little relationship, that opportunity to repair, to restructure, to rebuild, literally becomes your hope in life. That one little hope that says, no matter what's going on for me, I'm going to hang on to this hope of love, of peace, of honor, of dignity, of cherishing that relationship. And that's what people do. They do that in a way that makes sense to them. In business, we have relationships we cherish, if you will. We regard that we feel this strongly for that individual. We have strategic alliances that we go into business with, that we create and form team with, and we have a grand old time running around selling our lives away to produce a life worth living and retirement worth having. But when it doesn't go very well, we have to look at, okay, what didn't go well and why? And should I be responsible for some of it? And should the other party be a little bit responsible for their part? And then can we learn from those things and start anew? Can we try again? Can we just keep putting love, peace, honor, dignity, and regard for the plan that the Lord has between two or three or four or more people together in a way that makes the most sense, that will produce the result that the Lord is expecting, that the Lord has planned? But everyone expects things to go perfectly in the beginning stages of a relationship. And sometimes it goes beautifully, and then there's a snag. Love gets out of whack. The person who's on the sidelines interferes with the relationship that's going forward. And sometimes it's actual spouses of people that interfere with profitable partnerships that could take place amongst people that are not destined to be partners and other aspects of life. You see, everyone needs friends in this world, and everyone needs business partners, and everyone needs strategic alliances and spiritual counterparts that they can talk about God with, that they can talk about the Holy Spirit with, that they can really move their souls in a way that helps them to grow, to become a stronghold in the Lord's house. See, a stronghold in the Lord's house helps people. They just look at it and go, okay, here's who I am, here's who that person is. What can I do in this moment of time, right now, that changes the moment of time for that individual over there? Do I provide them employment for a short time? Do I provide them a gift of some kind? Do I provide them a place to stay out of the cold sometime? Do I provide them an opportunity to talk to other people that I know to see if there's an opportunity they can find on their own through just social conversation and business networking? But practically, that's what we're doing in life. We're literally looking at, how do I make a life worth living and retirement worth having by not stepping on so many people and by lifting and raising other people's light forces, the light forces that they receive from the Lord in through their birth parents, and through their sibling sets that eventually fade away because those siblings go off and have their own families, their own children, their own responsibilities, their own professional networks. But in our time, we have moments of time to make all the difference in the world for someone who dutifully loves us. Now, who is that individual? I can't say who it is for you. I know precisely who those people are for me, and I am longing to see her. No matter what, I will always love those individuals, even the one who crapped all over my name legally. I will always long to see her again, because that's what the Lord expects. He expects us to raise our vibrations into a place place that allows us to produce loving results. And when one party can't handle the love that they feel because of their social responsibilities or relationship responsibilities to other people that they chose poorly, that's on them. It's not on me. I'm responsible for continuing to give it a try, for continuing to reach out, for continuing to say, hey, still love you, still miss you, still can't wait to see you, and openly, my arms are wide open. The minute you stand in front of me, I'm going to grab a hold of you, and I'm never letting you go. I will never let you go again in my life. Because purposely, the Lord places a soul within our soul. What I mean by that is the soul keeping that we get, that the Lord places people on our path that change our lives, to raise us up, to push us forward, and then literally to transform us into better Christians, better human beings, and more loving people in this land. There's a whole bunch of mobbing type people that will literally take private information that's not their lawful right or their personal right to have any information about. And they would literally use it to try to destroy a person's life medically, physically, spiritually, psychologically, emotionally, and otherwise. Just because they feel like it. Just because they don't agree with what that person's doing in their life. That's why we have those school shootings. That's why we have the bombings across the world. Because people don't know how to make peace. You see, we have to learn how to make peace in the world. And that peace, as it's said in an old-time song of a woman whose music class I literally sang in as a junior higher, is you have to make peace on earth and let it begin with me. Now that's an old Ruth Artman song, and she's long gone since then, but she had a special needs child who suffered through a lot during that age and demographic of time period when she was coming into her adulthood. And I believe that's sort of partly where that song came from, but it was kind of a wonderful piece of music, and it's been played around the globe. It probably helped to pay for that child's life into adulthood long after her parents moved on to heaven. But in truth, we have moments of time to make all the difference in the world for someone who loves us beyond belief. How do you know who that person is? Because they won't simply just walk away. They'll walk away, they'll give you the space you request, they'll leave you at a distance, but they won't attack your life. And that therein lies the difference. There's a lot of people who say, I really care for you, I really concern for you, I really love you, but then they attack your life. They get involved in your professional life. They monkey it up. They get involved in your legal life, and they think they take liberties with your legal name. They get involved in your physical or mental health, which is not their lawful right because they are not lawfully you, and they are not mental health care providers, and they shouldn't be anywhere near that because they are not lawfully your official family. You see, once the birth family moves on to marriage and children and other things, there's a separation there. Legally, yes, there's still a bloodline, but lawfully, there is no official relationship. Having a sibling does not make them lawfully entitled to anything in an adult person's life. And I'm pretty clear about that with folks. But when I'm talking about producing loving relationships for professional partnerships, for understanding more about God, for spiritual talk, for open the opportunities to go out, hang out, have a beverage together, or help someone with the rearing of tough, waywardly boys, that's something I know a lot about. In my lifetime in language development training school, I had many parents come to me at the end of the tenure of the child's in my program saying, my child learned so much for you, or, you know, because my home has been broken, because we have two sets of parents here, my son could count on you as one of his third parenting-like parties. It wasn't exactly said like I was a parent, but it was kind of like I was said I was that stable force in that child's life. And while that child might not have produced perfectly because of all that was going on of moving and shuttling back and forth between parent sets homes, which is tough enough on any child, but to do it every single day or every few days is rough. But practically, that made me feel good. Now, when I talk about me, I'm sharing authentic truth of what has been said to me by professional people who I really respected, really regarded, and really valued because they paid me to look after their teenagers or their children or their life in some way with regard to my programming. And most of my students, most of my clients in that program, stayed with us literally 4 to 6 or more years. Those records are now long gone because I asked them to be taken care of once the children, the students and adults timed out of the program. There was a point where you kept them like you would do with a public school, but after a while I just didn't need to do it anymore. Now what happened to those records, I can't perhaps say. I've got someone who's always pilfering my schedule book and trying to voyeur in on my life, but that's kind of an odd thing, isn't it? I mean, I'm a grown adult person, and Other people are grown adult people, but I only look in on people every once in a while to see if they're happy, to see if they're well-loved, to see if they've practically found that life partner who makes them pleased. I think I've told the story a few times of a college girlfriend, my first serious love of my life, and openly, I just simply remembered her married name, and that was a very painful time when she literally left me and got married within seconds of leaving me. But openly, all I saw was a thumbnail print of someone with a similar name, and as I scanned those thumbnail prints, as you do in Facebook, I knew precisely which photo it was. And I was able to pick it out of all things because it was a family photo and I could see how one of her teen daughters was standing. She literally had the same stance that my girlfriend did and the same stance that her mother did, which I noticed when I visited them in Baltimore when we were seriously dating. You see, it's those little nuances that people remember. And when I look for my love in every blonde that drives by, and when I look for the one that I desperately long to see in every person who travels around a certain part of the interstate of Indianapolis, that other soulmate of mine, I'm always longing to see that loving face, that smiling, picturesque individual whose soul is just so lovely to me that it doesn't matter what difficulties we've gone through, doesn't matter what challenges we had, that a simple conversation of, hey, this is what I was looking at, this is what I was dealing with, this is what I was thinking, and this is what I was feeling at the time. But now I'm beyond that. I've moved on. I've got other things happening, but let's try and figure this out. And practically, in life, we don't have enough friends sometimes. You know, I've met strangers who've been more kind than certain people in my own birth family, and that's been amazing. Sadly, I've lost the website where I was tracking some of that, but I'm hoping to figure out how to do that. But I do have someone who's hazing me. I do have someone who's literally cutting my jacket when I sleep. I literally have someone who's stomping on my feet while I'm knocked out somehow. I've got bruises all over my toes that I can't explain. I've got all sorts of things happening. But what gives a person the right to damage another person's body without their consent? Monsters do that. There are monsters in this world. There are stormtroopers in this world who literally think they are the long arm of the Lord, and they're not. They're so far removed from the house of the Lord that they will never get the gifts of the Spirit and gifts of the soul that the Lord has for them. Now, practically, I've talked about a lot of things, but I love talking about spirituality, and that is where these Magic and Mayhem programs may go. I may start to produce what I've been longing to produce, just haven't been able to focus on. I may start to produce all that, and I pray that you be willing to listen and challenge yourself into what does soul care really mean? Who are the soul keepers of your life? And practically, if there's some music in the background because I'm in a decent little restaurant with some good old-fashioned music, I apologize for that. I'm not trying to swipe anybody's music. But in reality, when we're producing a life worth living and a retirement worth having, we must have the relationships that the Lord put in our life. You see, there's people we meet casually, and then there's those people that are literally shoved on our path in the most forceful ways that we know that the Lord has put them there for mighty reasons. The only question in life is whether or not we're smart enough, intelligent enough, dutiful enough, and frankly, mature enough to fix any difficult relationships we've had and openly to make amends to the point that love, peace, honor, dignity, and everything else that's supposed to flourish in those relationships starts to flow again. When life gets off track, it really can get off track. When people do monstrous things to damage a person in some way, shape, or form, the Lord will retaliate, and it will not be fun for that individual. But practically, I'm talking about real religious principles that are in many works across the nation, the world, and I talk about them regularly because I've literally read them. Not all of them. Got a lot more I'd love to read. But without a home, without a place to lay my head at night, it's sort of difficult. I carry a few books with me that I love to utilize in my own prayer casting, if you will. But magic is in the air. The magic comes from the Lord. The mayhem comes from people who think they know the Lord's plan for other people. And that is not true. People are never as smart as the Lord, and they can't outplay him. And that's what I find fascinating in my journey. There's always some human that is trying to outsmart the Lord in me as well as in themselves. That's a story for another day, folks. My name is Blake Ensign of Blaze Communications LLC presently, author of Soul Keepers, The Soul Strings of Our Lives, and several other works, including an upcoming screenplay and movie script, and actually another play But the main thing is called the Dragon Priest, and I am the Dragon Priest. You can tell by the dragons on my clothes, but you can also tell by the emblems that I carry with me that come from the Orient, that have religious meaning for me profoundly and openly. The priest is what's coming out now. So I wish you all the best. I wish you a productive business day, and I pray for you that you have all the relationships you need to flourish in your life so that you make a life worth living and retirement worth having.